Good evening, Harlem. Good evening. I want to take you tonight on a journey. I want to take you on a journey to a world without shareholders. And I take you on this journey bringing this raw material. And I tell you this, raw material is being used in primary school in the Netherlands by kids playing an entrepreneur's game, playing a business game. And they are in real business. They are in the business of friendship bracelets. And they are creating this virtual company during 4 sessions. So they have to start up a company, build a company, create a logo, make a prototype, and raise capital. Why raise capital? Because they have to buy the raw material. So in the second event of this training, of this serious business for them, they have to create this manufacturing unit because they have to produce themselves the friendship bracelets. So they create these prototypes, the design, and they make in 30 minutes as many bracelets as possible because they have to sell it on the third event, which is called the big sale. And in the big sale, they ask all the kids from the school to come in and in 45 minutes buy their bracelets. So many teams are competing with each other and they have really had to work on the sales strategy and the marketing strategy to get sales by other kids. And they all pay with Biz Euros. So this is the third event and these kids love it. They are creative, they work collaborative, they really push each other to the limits using their competence, using their talents. And in the fourth event of this training, of this class, they have to define, they have to calculate who is the winner. What company won? And they do it in the way we all do it, like each company. Last week, a company went in an IPO, and what they do actually, they look at profit, and then they multiply the profit with, let's say, 8 or 10, and then you have the valuation of a company. Some banks actually multiply it with 76, so you have some other standards on that. So at the end of this game, we have the calculation, like how many shares is a company, this virtual company, having, and what is the share worth? And some of the kids really have a lot of shares left. They took a loan at the bank, so they did not give away their shares to collect money, but they trusted themselves and their plan, and they went on the collateral. So at the end of the day, one team wins by a calculation, which is a great game for the kids. So they, you know, love to play, and they learned a lot on entrepreneurship. There's only one thing what I see and what I talked about with these kids as I was a trainer, it's based on old economy parameters. It's only based on profit as a fundamental. It's based on revenue. It's based on the value of a share. So actually, we learn kids at our schools to be an entrepreneur, which is fantastic, to collaborate, to use the talent. But what we also do, we let them at the end calculate and define who is the winner, and we do it by old economy standards. So let me continue this, our journey into a world with no shareholders. And I have to bring you back 406 years ago. I don't know whether you know what this is, but this is the oldest share in the world. And it was from Peter Harmens, and he paid 350 guilders. Remember that good old guilder time? He paid 350 guilders to get his share. And they did not call it a share, they called it a part. And he bought it from the Dutch East Indian Company, which had normally a nominal value, this share, of 3,000 guilders. So he really had to bring in, you know, parts of money, and this was the last time he paid 350 guilders and he got his share. And when you open up this share, you see actually the dividend, what was paid. You see it here on date. And in those days, they paid dividend with guilders, but they also paid dividend with products, with the spices, with gold, with metal. This is the dividend which this person got on his share. And what we don't know actually is that in the early beginning of the Dutch East Indian Company, it already was not going too well. It was really a capital-intensive company, so they had to raise 6,500,000 guilders to go abroad with these ships. So they had to raise the capital. And what did this company do, VOC? They were the first company in the world, actually, that gave the public the possibility to buy shares, to buy a part, as they call it. And they were the first company in the world to give the possibility to that wide public to transfer, actually, these shares. So they could not have imagined that 400 years later, kids were playing a business game with Biz Euros based on their idea of raising capital. And what was the business model behind it? It was the model like, okay, you invest, we make profit, we make revenue, and you get a part of this profit. So again, it is a profit-based economy, profit-based model. So let me bring us in a journey.
Hi, Kickstarters. I'm Charles Waugh, a professional photographer in Portland, Oregon. You know, I hate wiggly smartphone videos, and I'm sure you do too.
It's really short. I'm going to introduce this person in a few minutes again, because I am an investor. I'm a big-time investor. I invested $15 in his product. I could have used my money to invest in Facebook, but I didn't. So I chose for this product. And something extraordinary is happening when it comes to our journey towards a world without shareholders. We have many investors in this world that more and more are not looking at the revenue of a company or the profit of a company. They are also looking for, let's say, the sustainability or the responsibility indicators of a company. And they look and they see and they say, okay, this is a good company, a better company, so we invest in that. Like Calvert Investing. And they not only invest when a company is doing good, they even help companies to be better. So what did Calvert do? They helped Dell to become the first manufacturer to actually allow used product taken back. So this is this intermediate period where we are now. We came from shareholders with only revenue and profit dynamics in this profit-based economy. And here you see new investors coming up and even helping, pushing, negotiating with big companies to become, let's say, not only profitable, but also make the world more sustainable. So this is one example. And I will make the step to this company and this guy and my investment, but I have to make a short step in between. There is this other investor, not like investing in big companies, but in small startups, which is called Y Combinator. And they invest in many companies in a year with small amounts of money. They invest $18,000 for a period of 3 months in an idea or in an entrepreneur, even in an entrepreneur without an idea. And then they get $18,000 and they have to prepare for demo day. What is demo day? Demo day is a setting like this where these people, these entrepreneurs, after working for 3 months, are going to pitch their idea, their prototype, their beta version of a website to investors. And when they are successful, they raise $120,000. And this is quite a unusual. Have some. Okay. You pull it off, yeah? So after demo day, so this is like the part of the model, which is a bit old-fashioned. It is a small amount of money, it's for a small period, but at the end of the day, these guys want to have revenue because they invest. But what is Y Combinator doing more? They are putting these entrepreneurs in an ecosystem and let them learn from each other, facilitate each other, challenge each other. So they give more than only capital, they give them a ecosystem. And that is the step to this company. I am a backer from Slingshot. What is Slingshot? It is a device in which I can put my smartphone and then I can, with a Steadicam, make video. And I was not the only backer, because there are 20, almost 3,000 persons backing this company. And they reached the goal because they had to pledge 20,000 to actually manufacture the product and bring the product to the market. And you could have pledged by paying $15 or 50 or 100, but also by just pledging $1. And you would get a certificate, you are a wonderful person. So now we slowly come to that world without shareholders. Because what is, when there is a world without shareholders, there is space to fill that in with something new. So what is that something new? Here I give you the word, it's sharing holder. We are growing from a world with shareholders, with a shareholder-driven economy, with shareholder-driven values, with shareholder-driven economics, to a new world, where not the company is the person you invest in, but it is the product. Because I'm really proud that I'm invested in the product, in the guy, in the idea. So more and more you see that people participate and are investing in a product instead of a company. Also, not only financial capital is important here, but sweat capital, network capital. So I'm now sharing this story about my investment of $15, but at the email you saw, there was a request, share this with all your friends. So I am not only buying a part in a company, I just bought a piece from the pie of this adventure. So many aspects here, you see the difference between shareholder and sharing holder. So the question here is this a journey? What's going to take long? Because it took long to get from the VOC till the entrepreneur's game, some like 400 years. So do we have to wait another 400 years to end up in that world without shareholders? Or is it close by? Let me give you a cooperative, an energy cooperative, which is called Grunniger Power. They have members, and their aim in life, in doing business, is creating renewable energy by its members. And they bringing and delivering that renewable energy back to each other. And when there is leftover, they sell it and bring it to other ecosystems. So the founder was interviewed on Business News Radio, and he was asked, after he told how successful this company or this cooperative was, he was asked, okay, how and when are you going to expand your successful business? So Frans said, I am not going to expand, because we are Grunniger Power, and we are for our members in Groningen and its surroundings, so we are not going to expand. However, what we want to do and what we are willing to do, we want to share our knowledge, share our ecosystem, share our learnings. We want to share our business model. We want to share everything for other cooperatives, for other people to start up a similar initiative. So what we see is that the sharing holder driven community organization already are coming up. And let me conclude with the last example. What you see in our journey is that as we speak, shareholder driven companies or markets are already competing with sharing holders oriented companies. Here you see a new product, which is a smartphone. Sony is at the market at this very moment and is doing not too well with its smartphone, connected with a smartwatch, connected with a smartphone. Pebble was using a crowdfunding platform and actually received 68,000 backers. This product yet is not at the market. This product is not yet born, but is already paid for it, and people are already sharing this ambition, this idea. So in this current time, companies which are shareholder driven have to compete with companies that are sharing holder driven. Let me conclude. We are talking about new values in new economies. So what new value do you have to embrace as an organization in order to win or in order to really make good steps? That is the capacity to invite. So my invitation to you is let grow in your organization the capacity to invite. Invite people to come in, invite to co-produce, invite to suggest, and put sharing holder at your strategic agenda, because shareholder is already on it. Thank you.